And to finish this course, I may have to do just some reading without commenting, if I can do such a thing. So I may try to do a little bit of that. Exodus 29, dealing with the consecration of the priests. So from this, we see that the priest did not just, this whole chapter, he did not just consecrate himself to God in general. This is important. The priest did not just consecrate himself to God in general, because all Israel had already done that. All Israel claimed to be consecrated to this God, consecrated to the true and living God. So this is not, and a lot of times in Christianity and in altar calls and whatever, we talk about come down and consecrate yourself. But Israel was already consecrated in the ways that we talk about. The priest consecrated himself to sacrifice. That's what his consecration was. It wasn't just to God in general. It wasn't just to stay with the true God. It wasn't just to serve the right God. It wasn't just to tell people about God or to live a life that is pleasing to God. All the things we call consecration does not apply to a New Testament priest, because a New Testament priest consecrated himself beyond what Israel had already done. He consecrated himself to sacrifice. And so, and obviously this was a great privilege for a priest to do, the privilege of sacrificing to God and giving him the lamb on a continual basis, and that the giving of this offering that pleased God would be what would satisfy him more than all of the consecrating of our goods, all of the consecrating of ourselves to live faithful to God, all the things we apply to. You understand what I'm saying here? All the things that we would apply to consecration, the priests are well beyond that. They have, if you just said to the average Christian, well, if you consecrated yourself to God, what would that mean? They wouldn't come up with anything like what the consecration of the priests is relating to. And so to consecrate oneself to God is a commitment, not just to God, but a commitment to deny any earthly basis of relating to God. And I say that, any basis other than that you come only on the basis of what he deems acceptable, what God deems virtuous. In other words, we leave all for the Lamb. And notice my words, though. I said to consecrate oneself is a commitment to deny any earthly basis of relating to God. Here's the way a consecrated person would make that statement. I consecrate myself to commit myself to deny any earthly involvements. I won't go to movies. I won't dance. I won't do this. But that's not what a priest did. He consecrated himself to commit himself and to deny himself of any earthly basis of relating to God. In other words, all of the bases that any normal Christian would consecrate himself to God is the way that he would consecrate himself how to relate to God. I will relate to God by going to church. I will relate to God by reading the Bible, once every day, and praying for an hour every day. This is how we do it. We don't, in a certain sense, we don't change our relationship. We kick it up a notch, the way most people consecrate themselves. They do the same thing, only more. They do the same thing, only harder. Okay. This is not what the priest did. He didn't just do the same thing, only harder. He said, I am not going to relate to God based on my earthly life. He said, I am going to relate to God based on what he deems acceptable, on what he wants to separate me to, on what he says pleases him, not by doing, because when we talk about pleasing God, we go, okay, well, I'll do this and I won't do that, and I'll do this and I won't do that, which is not much different than being Jewish and keeping the Ten Commandments. No, the priest found out specifically what pleased God, and this is what pleased God outside of human effort. This is what pleased God outside of time. His Son was the Lamb of God before the foundation of the world. In the book of Revelation, he is the Lamb of God on the throne. This is the eternal aspects of the nature of the way God is. And a priest says, I'm going to be about that. Remember that we talked about being a priest after the order of Melchizedek, and that priesthood is without beginning and without end. When sin ends, the Aaronic priesthood ends, but not the Melchizedek priesthood. Okay. So, our lives as priests become focused only on what God has declared to us as what he finds acceptable or what satisfies his heart. You know, that's like when my girls were little, if they wanted to please me, many times they would think through to what they liked and then they would give that to me. Like if they had a favorite toy or something they really liked, they'd go, here, I'm going to give you, you know, even Abigail said that to me the other day. She goes, this is her night-night. She loves her night-night. It's her blanket that she sleeps with. She loves her night-night. And in the car going to Arkansas, she said, from now on, this is going to be our night-night. It's going to be yours and it's going to be mine. Well, you know, that was a big deal to her. To me, I'm kind of going, well, I'm not really into night-nights. You know, that's fine. And thank you for that heart, but the average Christian does the same thing. We find out what we really like, and then we're willing to take that away from ourselves to please God. You know. And so, and God's going, well, you know, there are things that I like a whole lot more than that. And it relates to his Son. And it relates to Christ. And so these priests are those who are dedicating themselves to listen to God and find out what it is and how he wants what it is presented so that it will truly, you know, there's a difference between pleasing someone and satisfying someone. Amen. You can please somebody by doing something real nice, but that doesn't necessarily satisfy them. There's not full satisfaction in that. Well, a lot of Christians can please God in a certain sense, but never bring him where he is satisfied. He is satisfied with his Son, and that's why God put his Son in us and said, that's the hope of glory. That's my hope of glory. Not just your hope. That's my hope. I'm hoping to get Jesus out of you. That's his desire. So, I said our lives are focused only upon what God has declared to us as what he finds acceptable. This means that we sacrifice the earthly views and rights of what we held as priority and as important in order to take up handling what he now imparts to us, meaning the priests are being consecrated. There's never been a priest before in Israel. They didn't know what this was about. They didn't know what they were going to be doing. They weren't given a job description. You know, you interview for the job, and you find out what you're going to do, and then you say, okay, well, I want to try for this job. That wasn't the case. The case was God was going to put something in their hands, and what he ended up putting in their hands was all these different sacrifices, all of them having a particular aspect of Christ. Not just randomly serving God, not just obeying the law, but living by the Son. Not just, as I said, randomly doing what most Christians think is acceptable, but not just trying to be acceptable, but trying to find out what it is that's in his heart when he created the earth, what it was that was in his heart when he created you. Your purpose for existence, the eternal purpose, not just, you know, my purpose on this earth, who am I going to marry, what kind of house am I going to live in, and am I going to, you know, how many kids am I going to have, and all that kind of stuff. No, this relates to the eternal purpose of God. And so it is what he puts in our hands that's important now, and it's no longer just my earthly view of what I thought. In other words, Israel in general out there might have had a view of what, an earthly view of what they thought was important to God. These guys are going to be told by God himself what he thinks is important. You know, is there anything higher? Is there anything higher than hearing from God for yourself? Hearing his heart. Not just hearing his commandments. Not just hearing it, but hearing his heart. And, you know, the scriptures do talk about obeying. Obey from the heart is what it says. And so, this, for the priest, this becomes, and remember, this is just a shadow of the true. We're supposed to be the true priests. Okay? So, that's what the focus of their lives was now changed radically to that. And becoming set apart, not because you're a great man or woman of God. You're set apart because you will bring about his interests. This is the difference between, you know, just being dirt, and you know, Adam and Eve were made from the dust, or Adam was made from the dust of the earth, and so we're all dirt. But good ground is what Jesus called for in the parable of the sower. And what is it that made it good ground? Simply one thing. That dirt was made, was molded, was dealt ingredients to make it more of an environment for the seed, which Galatians 3:16 says, which seed is Christ. That's the only thing that makes it good ground. It's not good ground because it does good all the time. I mean, listen to the parable of the sower. You know, it's the one that brings, that allows the seed to bring forth all of his fruit through it. That's good ground. It's not based on the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It's based on the life of the seed. And so that's what a priest basically has done. So the consecration of the priest began with all priests laying hands on, remember? Remember when the consecration began with the offering? There's a sin offering before them. Now, not everybody knows this, but most of you here know that when the sin offering, when Jesus died, he didn't just die for our sins, but for sin. And most of you know the difference. Sins is the fruit of sin. Sins is deeds and actions and wrong things. Sin is a nature. It is the nature of Adam. It is the fallen nature. And so when the priests begin, and as they begin to consecrate themselves, the first thing they do is they lay hands on that offering. And when they do, they're not just laying their sins on there. But they are saying by this identification, I am laying myself. I don't just believe Jesus died for my sins. I am crucified with Christ. They laid themselves on that bullock. And then they killed it. Now, this is significant. They laid their sins and they laid themselves and then they killed it. And then they walked away from it and they came over to this ram that was a burn offering, not a sin offering. They walked away from themselves. They died to their old life. And it was all put down and put to death. And they walked over to this ram of that was a burnt offering, a sweet savor offering. And they began to be involved with it. And the difference is Jesus just dying for sin, or Jesus dying because he lives, he dies to the glory of God the Father because it's his nature. It's a sweet savor to the Father. Not because he's putting away sin, but because it is his self-giving nature that the Father is pleased with. And that's the point of the sweet savor of the whole thing. So they're accepting death to what they were before. This is the consecration of the priest. This is the very beginning. They're not playing games and they're not going through rituals. They're understanding this bullock represents everything that we were before this moment. And we're saying that's us by identification, and now we're killing it. We're putting it to death, and we're walking off from it. And we're walking over here to the ram, the burnt offering that pleases the Father simply by nature and doesn't have to have a cause, because it is who he is. Doesn't have to have a cause. Most of us, we got more zeal, we got more when we got a cause. Jesus doesn't have to have a cause to lay down his life for the Father, for the glory of the Father to do it. It's just in him. It's who he is. And you don't, in the sin offering, you don't see so much of that. You just see a benevolent God coming down and becoming man and dying for our sins and saying, okay, you guys are messed up, I'll die for you. But in the sweet savor offerings, in the burn offering, the burn offering being what is called a whole burn offering, totally given to the nth degree. For what? The cause? The sin? No. The burnt offering has to do with one thing, and that is to the glory of the Father, and because he pleases the Father. And Jesus said that, I do always those things that please the Father. So they're accepting this death, and they're walking away from it saying, that's settled and that's done. And now I have a new life of involvement with God based on, I'm going to say it like this, resurrection lamb. Because that's what the burnt offering represents. Not pre-cross, in the middle of sin, dying. There wasn't always a sin offering going on, but there was always a whole burnt offering because it represents his nature. There was at no time that he's not self-giving and self-surrendering. So they're beginning this new life. They, you understand, represented by this death, this identification death in the burnt offering as a substitute for me. But now I am one with this risen lamb, the one who's raised with this nature and raised the body up to be partakers of the what? The divine nature. The divine nature. And so, and that's really, folks, that's what being a living sacrifice entails. That's what involved in being a living sacrifice. You're not a living sacrifice if you are a sin offering. It's not a living sacrifice. That's a dead sacrifice. Those of you who understand sort of laugh because you understand. All God wants out of that sin offering is just die. Die and go away. That the old man would be put away. That the old creation would be put away. That the first man, Adam, would be removed. But now there's a whole new reality. And it is another term for the burnt offering was the daily sacrifice. Every morning, it's going. Who's making it go? The priests. Every evening, it's going. Who's seeing to it? Not Israel. Not their consecration to God, because they're not consecrated to sacrifice. They're consecrated to God in general. The priests are making it go. Every day, morning and evening, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. Folks, that's what this is. You know, all of these things are fulfilled by Christ at the cross. So there are no happy scriptures apart from the reality of Christ and Him crucified. You know, for example, this is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Has anybody ever really looked at that scripture? Check the context of it. It's dealing with the cross. It's dealing with death. It's dealing with the putting away of us and being tied to the horns of the altar. Then it says, this is the day. Moses didn't walk out and go, oh, look how beautiful it is. This is the day that the Lord, he didn't make yesterday? This one's the one He made? Or, you know, last week? 2 weeks ago, that bad day I had, He didn't make that one. Folks, the day, not a day. This is a day that the Lord has made. That'd be the true translation as understood by most Christians. Check the context of that scripture. I challenge you to do that. It is speaking of the day. The day. In death and resurrection with Christ. And then He becomes the bride and morning star. The morning star is the sun coming up. That's where you start seeing light instead of your darkness. See? And so, this ram of the burnt offering, this now gets into what being a living sacrifice is. Of course, that was only a shadow back then. We live in the real. That was a shadow. They got up in the morning, and before they went to bed at night, they made sure that that was going up as a sweet savor. That's what it was, to God, a sweet savor. Well, folks, when we get up in the morning, we go to bed at night, and all day long, we let the sweet savor of Christ come out of us. This whole burnt offering going up to God out of us. Not just us being consecrated to Christianity. You know, I don't see anywhere in the Bible where you're supposed to be consecrated to Christianity. You're supposed to be, as priests, consecrated to the Lamb, to the sacrifice, to the offering. And so, the burnt offering comes up after death, if you will. It is, and it was before death. And it was before the world began. And it will be, because it is always going. It's another term used in the scriptures, a continual burnt offering. And so these men understood this when they put themselves to death in this sin offering, not just remove their sins, but I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I. You can say, I am crucified with the burnt offering, nevertheless I live, yet not I. I'm sorry, I am crucified with the sin offering, that's correct. I am crucified with the sin offering, nevertheless I live, yet not I. It is the burnt offering that is continually going up to the Father. Hallelujah. And it's the self-giving nature of Jesus in us on the resurrection side, and giving himself because it is living, or it is life. What kind of life? Lamb life or sacrificial, however you want to word it. The important thing is to understand the nature of this whole priesthood. Involves some offering giving itself for everybody else's mess ups. That's the important thing to understand. Doesn't matter what you do, doesn't matter how many people come to the door of the tabernacle, he's there, he gives himself, he pours out his life that we might have life. Okay, so that's it. And it is life, but it is, you need to understand that this is his kind of life to do this. It's not our kind of life, and you try to lay that on the average Adam, and he does not want it. No, sirree, no. I want to be happy. I want everything to go my way. I want everybody to bow and scrape to me. You know, Jesus came to serve. And there wasn't a person on this planet that he didn't serve that wasn't a sinner, didn't have a wrong motivation. Can I get an amen from anybody? My God, everybody was, they weren't in darkness, they were darkness. You know? And so, the scripture says, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3, is it? 4. That we are bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. Now, explain that to me. Bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord. I thought he already died and it's a finished work. It's ing. It's an ongoing process. Dying. We're bearing about in the body the dying. Folks, he's not dying for sin. And don't apply that to he's dying so your old man will be dead. He's putting to death your old man. Those scriptures do not apply to the old nature or the Adam. He's not dying in you so that if anybody was dying in you daily, it'd need to be the old man, not Jesus. The old nature, amen? This is his nature. So then Paul gives the fruit of it. So then death works in me, but life in you. See? So that's not a past finished work. The cross, as a work done for us through redemption and salvation, is a past finished work. Christ continually giving himself in you is not a work of redemption. It's the work of the life of the nature of the Redeemer. It's who he is. He's not going to live. He's not going to get inside of you and go, oh, I just want things. I'd like a big throne. And you know what I'd really like is a big stereo or a little one, an iPod. That's what I want. You know, I mean, you think Jesus is doing that in you? He's not. That's you doing that in you and claiming it's God, you know. It's called the prosperity gospel. You know, Christ in me really wants an iPod. You know, there went a whole 30 minutes of preaching right there. All right, so our bodies are presented as the vessel of the living, sacrificing lamb. It is a living sacrifice. It is a living sacrifice. So let's look in Exodus 29 here, verse 17 and 18. In Exodus 29, verse 17 and 18, it says, "And thou shalt cut the ram in pieces and wash the inwards of him and his legs and put them unto his pieces and unto his head. And thou shalt burn the whole ram upon the altar. It is a burnt offering unto the Lord. It is a sweet savor, an offering made by fire unto the Lord." if you really listen to the wording of this in verse 17, it says, thou shalt cut the ram in pieces and wash the inwards of him and his legs and put them unto his pieces and unto his head. It sounds to me like the head is already first put on the altar, then it's cut up, then you put the pieces to the pieces and to the head. In other words, there's a joining of these pieces to the head and to one another. Do you see that the wording of that is, I mean, it looks pretty clear to me. It doesn't seem sketchy at all. That the and remember now, this is a shadow. So the only true way to discover if this is true, what I'm saying, is to see the true. Okay? Is to see the true. So I'll read what I got here in Exodus 29, 17 and 18. In the burnt offering, the head is laid on the altar first, which is Christ, and all the members are joined to him. Does that make sense? Does that sound scriptural, that Jesus goes to the cross and we're joined to him? We don't go to the cross. He takes us to the cross. We're joined to him in his altar. We're joined to the head in his self-givingness that's taking place here. And after the head, then the rest of the parts are the whole body, which is those which are dead with him. Those, because remember now, it's about to be burned up, but it's already been cut up. You know, the ram's not sitting there going, oh, this hurts, or oh, this is, he's already dead. They're dead with him. All the parts, all the pieces, the whole body is joined with him in his death. And they're washed in the word that has taken place prior to this. So we're all laid on the same altar along with the head. And that is the true New Testament fulfillment of that. And so here we have Jesus presenting his body, his many members, as a living sacrifice, as a burnt offering. In other words, this burnt offering, self-giving spirit was never meant to reside only in Jesus. It was meant to be head and body joined to head in the burnt offering. It was always the intention. A lot of times we put everything on Jesus, but folks, we are his body. We're one with Jesus. If it happened to Jesus, you know. I mean, you could say you're inside of there. And if I walked up and I didn't care anything, you know, I didn't have a problem with your body, but I didn't like your spirit, and so I punched you, and I punched you to hit your spirit, there's a good chance that I would hit your body first. Well, let's try it. The thought being that Jesus is not separate from his body. And you know, he wasn't separate in death. The Bible says we are crucified with Christ. The Spanish reads, con Cristo estoy juntamente, jointly crucified. And it is the more clear translation. We are jointly crucified with Christ. Why? Because we were there. We were taken in union with him. Because you never got crucified other than the fact that he did. The only way you know for sure you're crucified is he said, I made you one and then took you into death. That is the only way that you know for sure. It's called faith. And it's called faith in the sacrifice. We're going beyond what the Jews did. We're believing the real deal. We're not believing in shadows. We're not going through the motions. Or we're not supposed to be. We are supposed to be knowing the Lord, being filled as earthen vessels like censers with the sweet incense of Christ, and letting him burn on the inside of us and rise as a glory to the Father. That's not shadow, folks. That's the real deal. The question is, are we doing that? The question is that, are we the New Testament fulfillment, or are we just following what we've been taught in the Old Testament ways of saying stuff and doing stuff and thinking that we're still, you know, pleasing to God because we're going through the motions? All right, so the burning of it all on the altar is God accepting it as a sweet savor of Christ, because it's a sweet savor offering. Again, it's not a sin offering for what you did wrong. It is the, remember the Bible says the first man, Adam, was a living soul, but the last man, which is Jesus, is a life-giving spirit. Now we say, well, he gives life. Yeah, but he's always giving his life. He's life-giving. He's always giving his life. And he gave us of that life, his life. So if he is a life-giving spirit, meaning that he gives life to us, there's only one way he could give life to us, and that is he would have to give his life. You understand the difference? He has to be self-giving. Not just, he doesn't have a basket with a bunch of little life particles in it. And goes, oh, you want life? Here, you get life. And now you get some. And oh, you get a little life too. And then he merrily skips off and says, oh, it's such a joy to be a life giver. No, he gave his life to give life. He's not just a merry life giver. He was despised and rejected of men. But to as many as received him, to them became the sons of God. So, as parts of the offering, it's important that we see that we, what does the scripture say? If we be dead with Christ, what is that? Colossians 3:1, I think, or 1-3, somewhere in there. If we be dead with Christ, let me put that in bad English. Folks, we be dead with Christ. We be dead. That's what I'm talking about. We be dead with Christ. And the scripture says, if we be dead with Christ. Well, we are. And so this is, I said, as parts of the offering, it is important that we see we be dead with Christ, not just his death for us. Now, never do I mean to take away from the fact and the reality of his death for us. And I, you know, maybe some of you are getting tired now of my teaching several semesters in a row of what it means to be a New Testament priest and what was the other one, sacrifice or something. I taught, oh yeah, offerings, and then I only got to the burnt offering. But I'm thinking next semester, now I can call it feasts, but I probably won't get out of the Day of Atonement. So Scott's going to be teaching tabernacle, da 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 da, this, that, and that. So you're going to be tabernacled out or in. Praise God. There is an incredible thing that happens on the Day of Atonement. And most of us say, the priest went in and did an offering and came out and said, we're all free. No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the particulars of what that did and what it meant, instead of just a general sort of a, you know. So we'll get into that next semester. All right, so we're members of the body of the head, and his death is our death. And so we're not just acknowledging that he died for us. We're acknowledging oneness. And in oneness, we're able to be separated from what we cannot defeat in ourselves. Anybody feel like there's something in your life you cannot defeat? Well, I would say that your whole life you can't whip it, you know. It's going to take death with Christ. It's going to take the understanding of that. And, you know, I can teach forever, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, Christ liveth in me. But there's something about seeing the reality of what, how that was brought about, that you can stick your faith on. You know what I mean? It's like attach your faith to something other than, you know, a scripture or some man's teaching or where, you know, it's like, you know, getting the Holy Spirit or something, having something you can sink your teeth into instead of just, oh, it's all mystical and oogie boogie and, you know, good luck, you know, that sort of deal. No, it's much, much, much more than that. Praise God. Hello, Joan. Good to see you. Missed you. It's good to see you. You look healthy, wealthy, and wise. All right. So, and this same principle of oneness can be seen in relationship with the high priest, because picture this. Here's the high priest, and he's standing in the midst of his sons, okay? Standing in the midst of his sons, and this is the day of consecration, which is what we've been going through for week after week now in Exodus 29, the consecration of the priest. And so here's the high priest, and he's the head. He's the family head, is he not, of these sons? He's also the religious head as high priest. Not just of them, but certainly of them. And so so you have to realize that in God's, not the Old Testament shadow, and a shadow never gives full clarity to the real. Or if it did, it wouldn't be a shadow, would it? You just go, well, there it is. You know, who needs Jesus? That's clear. You know, but no, it never brings it out. In other words, you're still going to have the Holy Spirit open your eyes or you'll never see it. And so we view this consecration service, and we view this high priest standing there, and we view these sons gathered around, and we say, you know, praise God, you know, they're all going through this together and everything, but it was way, way, way more intimate than that. I wrote, what happened to the high priest happens to the other priests as well, because in type and shadow, they represented his body. Now, you can see that, keep your place here because we'll probably come back, but you can see that over in Psalms 133. David was a man who tended to see beyond the shadows. Did you ever notice that? I mean, he's got Zion was, I'm going to say it like this. This is obviously not the best way to do it, but it'll help make my point. He created Zion, and we know God did. But, I mean, he's the one who had, you know, brought the Holy of Holies only into his backyard and then went in there and spent time with God. Like he was some sort of high priest. I mean, this man saw through the shadows many times into the real and into what was going on. And here it says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard. Folks, this is the anointing of the priest, the consecration of the priest, that went down to the skirts of his garments. He's talking about this being like descending from Mount Hermon, the dew. That frankly, it was hot over there, it's the Middle East, and much of the moisture that they got came from Mount Hermon. That's where they got all their dew from. And you can check all this stuff out on your own. And don't believe me just because I said it, but it's good to look these things up. But then he says, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life evermore. Folks, this is a flow of life coming down, and he's using Aaron and his sons as a true picture, saying that it really wasn't Aaron and boys. It really wasn't Aaron and his sons. It was Jesus and his body. It was the high priest, and all of this, the shadow was Aaron and his sons, but that was only a shadow because he, you know, you would say it like this, because he couldn't squish those guys up, those four sons up, and make them his body and stick him as a head on top of it. I mean, you know, he couldn't do that. But Jesus did. Jesus became the head of the body. We became his members, but in type and in shadow, he couldn't do that. So he just gathered four sons around and said, we're all of the same DNA. We're all of the same thing. But now here we're getting the true picture of this thing. Jesus is the anointed and no one else is the anointed. He's the Christ. He's the anointed. And if you got any anointing at all, it flows down from him. And guess what? It didn't flow. He didn't anoint Jesus and then it drop off over here on one finger and that finger get all the anointing and go, I'm the anointed man of God. Come to me. I'm the one you need. I'm the only one and really anointed like this. Because we would just laugh at that one finger doing that. We'd go, that looks stupid. But we look at TV and we go, oh my God. He must be, because people are laying down and stuff. You know, and I'm not trying to put them down. I'm trying to lift up the truth. You know, that can go on or whatever. I'm not out, you know, I'm not on a witch hunt. I want to lift up Christ. And the true meaning of all of that, folks, is that the anointing only came on one person and flowed down to the rest, and that this is the unity. It's the unity of the body. This is where God commanded the blessing. The blessing is when we're plugged into him by oneness, we draw life, we draw everything from him, and we're seen as one with him in these things. So I'll read that again. So what happened to the high priest happened to the other priests as well, because in type and shadow, they represented his body. In other words, none of this would happen to them if the high priest wasn't there, not even in type and shadow, because it would be a false picture. Because it has to have him there, because he's why it's happening to them. See, we separate ourselves from God and we say, oh God, make me the anointed person. Oh God, give me this. Oh God, do that. Why can't we just receive it as one with Jesus? Why can't we say all that he has, I have? I can believe for that. I believe in oneness more than I believe in, you know, I was thinking of the scripture the other day. It says in James, every good and perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights. And so our minds, you know, we're going, okay, so I want to get some of them good gifts. So I'm going to pray that God's going to give me some of them good gifts. And clearly the Word of God says that God is up there and the gifts are there, and all we got to do is get them from him. Okay. Folks, it says they all come down from the Father. They only come down to the Son. They didn't come from God. They come from the Father to the Son. And you are not just in covenant with the Son. You are in union with the Son. You can break a covenant. You can't break union. If you're one, you know. If you're one, you're one. Somebody said to me the other day, said, well, I think the devil may be attacking marriages. I think the devil's attacking marriages and making them fall apart. I said, well, he can attack marriages and make them fall apart, but he can't break oneness. If your marriage is simply a I do thing with a certificate, that certificate will not keep you together. I don't care what it says on there. It says, united this day, da 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 da. Folks, somebody can just go, okay, it's over with. Right? You know, you can mean it with all your heart on your wedding day. I do. But, you know, when he got his stinky socks and underwear thrown all over the house and, you know, it doesn't clean up anything and everything's a mess all the time and whatever, you're going, I don't! You see what I'm saying? But when you're joined in the Lord, do you even understand what that means? That's marriage. That's oneness. But that the shadow is called marriage. Don't do this in shadow land. Don't be a shadow. Let it be Christ in you, and let it be Christ in the other person, and let it be the eternal oneness that we have in Christ, because that's what God's given you. Now, you know, I shared this in Arkansas. I mean, if you're, you know, if he's here and you're out over here and you're saying, I'm not one and he's so big and I'm not dead and all this stuff. Well, if you deny him, he'll have to deny you because you're denying the one you're one with. So you're saying you're separate. So you're a separate entity and he has to deny you because he cannot, it goes on to say, he cannot deny himself. He won't deny himself as long if you're one with him, then you're cool. But if you're out there going, hey, you know, and I'm not talking about, you know, we have our season, because it says if we believe not, yet he abides faithful, he cannot deny himself. So you can, but if you start saying, no, I'm not one with Jesus, I don't act one, I don't think like I'm one, everything about me is contrary to him, then you've just denied him and he has to deny you. He's not embracing what is not one with him. What is one with him is what the new creation is. You know, I could say more about that, but the new creation is you and him together. It's not something you joined. Yeah. I joined new creation. Maybe you joined this group here, but I hope you got more than this. Because I do. I have more than this. I have way more than this. I am not depending on this. I'm depending on the fact that I'm one with Jesus. I am in him. I am in Son, like it says in Hebrews. And I'm holding on to that with everything that I'm walking by the faith of that. I'm walking by the faith of that. And that part is exciting. And being one with anybody that's of that spirit and nature is exciting. Being with people that aren't is... Thank you. That said it better than I could have ever said it right there. That was magnifico. All right, so let me just read the last of this because I'm being signaled we're almost done here. I may have read it all here. So we are not just sons like Aaron's priesthood because we're not of the priesthood of Aaron. We're not of the Levitical priesthood. And even if he did have sons, Jesus has a body. And you were sons of God in Christ, but that's the picture God wants to bring forth is of union. And we're not just brethren. I mean, I know it says, behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. He describes two things, brethren and unity, and then he says, but here's what it's supposed to be like. One, head, Jesus, and everybody getting whatever they get from him. One, no brethren involved in that, and no unity involved with that, just oneness. You know what I'm saying when I say unity. I'm saying different pieces trying to get along. You know. They're not of the same kind. They'll get along for a while, but eventually you'll find something that you don't like. You know? It's just the way that it is. We're all that way. So it has to be something greater than unity. It has to be oneness with Christ. And that's why when he was talking about the offering, the head is put down there, and then the members are joined unto one another and the head. Because you know what? You're not just members of Jesus' body. You are that, but you are members one of another, too. That's what it says. All right, so let's see. not just brethren, but the two unity of a body, the true unity of a body and the oneness of it. So I guess I'm going to stop here and see how it goes next class. All right, take a break.